like the hundred.
So Rob, you gotta do that, recite that song about David killing Goliath. I saw it on the video. You gotta
read. I used to know all the words, and he cut out the words that I couldn't remember. What were the words? So what's inside? Anything nice?
You'll have to come in and take a look for a minute.
Okay, I'll take a look.
Yeah. Boy, the engine looks so small when you have the covers off.
Yeah.
Doesn't it?
We have to go with her.
Huh?
We have to go with her right now.
Oh, I see. That looks neat. They got a long way to go yet.
Yes. They only work on it Tuesday evenings and Saturdays. It's just a group of volunteers. So
yeah.
They think it'll probably be another 5 to 10 years before they're done.
Wow.
Well, we won't be here. They got to hurry.
Might be here.
And how long it took them to build them in the first place?
I don't know.
Not very long.
No.
They just bonded these two halves together. They put all the instruments in it before they bonded together, and it was quite easy to put together.
Yeah. So when De Havilland first came up with the idea for the Mosquito, the Air Force kept saying, nope, it's not happening. And then finally, when it did get approved, it only took them 6 months before they had the first one in the air.
Hmm. Pretty fast, isn't it?
Yeah. Didn't take long, and then after that, it was just,
stamp them out like cookie cutter.
Yeah, exactly.
They built 7,700, something like
that. Yeah, I don't know the exact number, but it was quite a lot.
Yeah. Wouldn't it be amazing to see a field of 7,000 sitting together?
I couldn't even imagine, it would just be incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really cool how they made it, though, because it's just a really thin layer of plywood, and then balsa, and then another layer of plywood. Mm. And as long as they are properly glued together, this is thicker than metal. It's harder to shoot through, which is just incredible.
Mm.
Yeah. The one under here, and then the one behind it somewhere. Because it sat in storage for a number of years and the balsa ended up starting to rot, so they had to take out a lot of the balsa.
So that's all they have, they've replaced all that already, huh?
If it doesn't have a stamp on it, it is original.
Okay. Yeah, it looks pretty good, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, they've done a pretty incredible job.
Yeah, and they're all amateurs and they
yes,
they
yes.
have to get extra keys from probably those people in New Zealand,
yeah,
right?
A lot of it, yeah, is talking to people and reading books and just, yeah, doing their best because they love it.
Kind of intact with the engines and everything?
Yeah, we have both the engines, and then the wings are just in the back there.
Yeah.
The nose piece is somewhere over there.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to have it in running condition, aren't they?
Yeah.
So they'll be able to start them up with the Lancaster at the same time.
And then eventually the Halifax as well.
This is the Arrow Anson. Dad used to work on these planes. He used to fly in this plane too.
I can take five, and so the dog man and the dog got in the truck with him and three other guys. And Gary McLeod said, I'm not going with them, they're going to crash. I know they're going to crash. So he stayed with me in the airplane, another couple of guys stayed with me. Sure enough, about 20 minutes out after they departed with the truck in the middle of the night in the rain, in the dark, they went off the road.
Really?
Down a cliff, and the only thing that stopped them was a tree.
Yeah?
They didn't make as much headlines as you did.
No. And Chris, what was his name? Horton? What was Horton's first name? Curtis Horton, yeah. He says, like, we got out of the vehicle, and everybody's kind of shaking a little bit. Nobody's really hurt, but damaged the vehicle, and the dog immediately crouched down and had a big dump, and he was looking over his shoulder at me going, saying, you stupid. Put me in this truck.
So who said they didn't want to be in the truck? The guy that you came to look for?
Just one of the members, Gary McLeod.
Oh.
So he and a couple of guys stayed with me and didn't have to go down the cliff. The next day, Mike Rosarco came with a bunch of plywood, and we had to inch the airplane around on plywood, putting plywood in front of the wheels as we turned. We had it turned around 180 degrees. So then, once turned, we were on that firm part of the runway that you had misidentified. And so we took the seats out and got as light as possible, and I just... The rest of the guys went with Mike, and I was solo as I did a short field takeoff.
Yeah.
On the remaining runway, it was only about 600 feet or something. Everything was fine. Luckily, we didn't have really a lot of extra fuel, so didn't have to worry about fuel.
Where was this place that this guy was lost?
About 100 some miles north of Whitehorse.
Oh. He was missing and walked out of the bush and found you guys, huh?
Yeah, he found somebody. House.
It's going to be a disaster. Doug said it's going to be a disaster if they don't hold the house.
He's running the joint again.
Yeah, he's very worried about it. Everything will grind to a halt. Respond
I remember hearing about that, yeah.
Respond to Doug's demand.
Maybe later.
You got to respond to Doug's request for breakfast before Christmas.
What am I going to say?
Hi, Doug. I got your message and the warning about paying for breakfast, and it has to be before Christmas, and I promise to be there before Christmas, just not this Christmas. And it's snowing here now, and we don't drive anywhere in the snow, not that far anyway. And we're too cheap to fly. But I'm waiting to see that picture that's signed by Donald. That's pretty cool. Have a good Christmas. Take care.
Oh, is that right?
Well, I guess this is our departure, huh?
Yeah.
Hey, Doug, it's below zero here today. 4 or 5 below zero.
There's another pilot behind us.
Rick.
Yeah.
Another RCMP pilot.
International flights here, huh?
Yeah, feel it yourself.
Yeah, Delta.
I guess we're
I'm with Alaska Airlines.
Yeah, it could be here.